At a time when doctors, scientists, researchers, healthcare experts across the globe are struggling to develop a vaccine, Baba Ramdev very confidently walked up to a stage and spoke about Coronil, which was loud, widely reported as this cure for the much dreaded coronavirus. Now, it snowballed into a controversy, post which Patanjali was pulled up by the Ayush Ministry. But exactly a week later, he was told that he was allowed to sell the drug, the kit, as an immunity booster, if not a cure. So, well, Patanjali inadvertently ended up getting a lot of publicity for manufacturing an immunity booster. And in the process, it has managed to put the spotlight back on whether controversies really help in selling a brand. And to discuss that today on Creative Talks, we have some very well-known faces from the industry. Let me start from the senior most, one of the most respected ad makers in the country, Prahlad Kakkar, who's also the founder of Genesis Films. I don't think there's anyone who doesn't remember Pepsi's Nothing Official About It ad made by him, I think, which is also your favorite, Prahlad.
No, but excuse me. I mean, what do you mean by respected? Nobody will believe anything that I say from now on. If you call me respected. If you turn on, say, blunt, forthright, politically incorrect, yes. Respected.
Okay, so in that case, we'll make peace with politically incorrect Prahlad Kakkar. Also, we have Manish Bhatt, founder, Careco, MNC, Saatchi, who by his own admission has made a host of controversial ads. We have Santosh Paddy, CCO and co-founder, Taproot Dentsu, whose agency Taproot is still, I think, held as a benchmark by many admin who are trying to venture out on their own. And lastly, we have Shombit Mohanty, head of Creative South at McCann World Group. If your last image of Pierce Brosnan was that of holding a pan masala can, then you need to thank him for it.
Poor Pierce Brosnan, he could never live it down because he didn't know what the product was.
So welcome to the show. And before we start there, let me tell you, we are streaming this discussion live on Twitter, Facebook and LinkedIn. And we will be happy to take any questions on any of these platforms. So coming back, this is clearly not the first time that Patanjali has been in the eye of the storm. Baba Ramdev and the company have had a long history of making really absurd claims to cure a bunch of diseases like HIV, cancer, quote unquote, I think, cure homosexuality, and even, you know, help women conceive a male child. So this appears to be a tried and tested formula to feed into the fear of the people. The question is, will it really work for the brand? Prahlad, let me start with you. What do you think?
See, what happens with somebody like Baba Ramdev is, unless he tries it on himself and proves as a test in the market, whether he takes the medicine orally or anally, we don't really know because he hasn't said how you take the medicine. But whatever it is, if one hand he takes the COVID medicine, other hand a doctor injects him with the COVID, viral, and then 14 days later, if he's still alive and not wheezing his guts out, then we'll say, wow, he found a cure. I mean, it's a very simple before and after tried and tested advertising, stunt. Is that you try it on yourself? Why turn on, make a claim, find 500 people have died, and then everybody's suing you, and then go underground in a woman's clothes, thinking with a beard, and say, I'm the bearded lady from the circus.
So, yeah, midnight crackdown, yes.
Exactly. I mean, when he started his career with one controversy, which is when he tried to be a Gandhian, and Gandhi took a lathi from the British cops when they were going on the salt march. And Baba Ramdev did one better. He dressed up as one of his women and was trying to turn around and pass himself off as a bearded lady from the circus.
Okay, that was innovative. Shombit, let me come to you. You're the youngest, I think, on the panel. What do you think? Do you think this is going to work for Patanjali?
See, Patanjali has always believed in this maxim of fake it before you make it, right? I think they have never believed in doing proper, at least that's my belief, that, you know, they don't believe in doing R&D. In fact, they treat the customer as a guinea pig. So we'll launch the product first, let the customers try it out. And if the people like it, and if they take a shine to it, hey, we have already made a dent in the market and will continue to grow in that category. So that has been always been their approach, you know, sort of to jump down a cliff and grow their wings on the way down kind of a thing. But I think what has happened over a period of time with Patanjali as a brand, it has lost a lot of its equity because of the spurious quality that they put on the table, right?
Bang on.
Uber is clearly not a moron. He will try your product once and twice, but after that, he's going to reject it outright. So with Patanjali, and especially with, I think they're just trying to cash in on this entire paranoia around COVID-19. And which is why they launched Coronil. To my mind, I think the word which defines it is nil. It's going to do nil for people who have contracted COVID or who are afraid of contracting COVID, because this is just an eyewash to my mind. It is just an attempt to ride this bandwagon of fear and paranoia and distress and make money. So. I don't think it is going to really be something which consumers are going to take a shine to. But end of the day, I think we are a nation of 1.3 billion people. There are enough and more gullible people out there who would want to give it a try. So actually, you never know.
What about you, Manish? Do you think it's going to, it's all noise and it's not really going to help the brand?
So I think I'll try to, even though I'm a creative person, I'll try to make a little, try to answer like a marketing guy. So I'll, what I understood is that actually awareness is something which such stunts can manage. But building a brand and sustainable image is impossible through the shortcuts of advertising. I remember I was in Ogilvy and I think that time my boss used to ban me from using toilets, some of those cliches like in visuals, like there's the sex or something, some condom, something. So there were, I think, a lot of juniors used to come up with an idea using Poonam Pandey, Sunny Leone, this, that and all. And just to, so those things are absolutely, kind of to do a fly by night sort of a buzz. You can do that, but life is longer than brand life is much longer than these one off. And I think over a period of time, these things will not work. However, he is more credible than this footpath or a footpath ke Baba. He's a little bit more credible, and I think that's there are enough people who are the God. Belief and lot of those things. There are tantra, mantra, kala, jadu, this, that. In that, I think these things obviously are going to cut through, and he's much more organized and systematic in that area. And I think we have lots of population of people.
I'd like to come to you also, Paddy. You know, it's a known fact that Patanjali is struggling with market share losses in many, many FMCG categories at this point. Would you say a controversial cure for COVID was just the magic bullet it needed at this point?
Put the nail on.
See, I think I completely agree with all these three guys. I think they echoed each other. And I feel a little bit of credit has to be given to him, because I think the entire brand wasn't built purely on controversies. I think there was something good about that brand, where they spotted that India, who is the creator of Ayurveda, needs to be given back. But then after that, I think he didn't have the vision to go to the right people. Today, I think whatever we do, you need to have right partners. If I have a script, I'll go to the Pallas of the world to make it magical. Hence, he never ever got the right partner to do justice to the core idea. He never came to the right set of people like us to take the brand forward. And that's where I think he absolutely messed it up, because it has a potential. It had spotted the right ingredients. It had spotted the right target audience. And those values were there. But as I said, I think he didn't have the vision to come to people like us to take it to another level. Or there were many set of people. I think he was too greedy to keep the product to himself. I mean, a brand who is launching right from ghee to jeans. Where do you stand? Exactly. Where do you stand? And what kind of strategy is this? I think I have heard there are a lot of fabulous product in the lineup. He should have just concentrated on those. His honey did magically well initial days. His soaps did well. Oil did well. But they should have just concentrated on the packaging. That sucks. It never appeals to me. If they had have put little bit of effort, energy and thinking behind it, I would have gone and bought it. I would have become a fan of it. So he took a lot of things for granted, and hence I think the brand never flew, and it's backfiring now, because that's the power of communication. That's the power of strategy. That's the power of visionary, which I think he never had.
He's kind of become reduced to, you know, he's become the controversy's favorite child to a very large extent, more than the brand that he's known for. I think that's what it has done to him. You know, we don't want to limit the discussion to Patanjali. So I want to ask someone who's been there and done that, basically create shockwaves in a rather drab pan masala market with none other than James Bond. Shambhit, you brought in Pierce Brosnan for a Pan Bahar ad all the way from Hollywood. Now, I know I'm digressing here, but I really want to know how that even happened.
So, I know there's a lot of controversy that particular act, and I would consider that particular piece of work as an act and not so much an ad, because we never set out to create something controversial. It was more of a marketing ploy, I would say, a disruptive strategy in a market where Pan Bahar as a brand was probably fourth or fifth, and number one was this brand called Rajnigandha. And it happened to become controversial because of the nature of the product, and also because, of course, a former Bond was endorsing it. That's something that nobody had ever imagined would happen. Now, I think Pan Masala is a product that inherently suffers from an inferiority complex. You know, there is very little glamour associated with having Pan Masala as opposed to cigarettes or alcohol. And which is why I think celebrity endorsements play a really major role in making it look appealing to the masses. But from the outset, I think we are very clear that we didn't want a Bollywood celeb. I mean, we were like, let's go big or go home. So which is why my suggestion was that, you know, if you have to do it, then let's do it with a global star. And at that time, of course, Daniel Craig was already the new Bond. But Pierce Brosnan was very much fresh in the minds of people as Bond, you know, and Pan Masala is usually consumed by a slightly older age, and most people people identified with him as Bond. So on one hand, you had the competition which had Manoj Bajpayee, Ajay Devgan, Shah Rukh even endorsing Pan Masala. And on the other, you had James Bond, who's an international icon, endorsing a local brand. So absolutely, I think it really created a lot of shockwaves rather, but the impact it also had on sales was unprecedented. I mean, the brand grew by almost 20-25% that year.
Yeah. But in that case, you know, though the brand association was a little difficult to make, because, you know, nobody would imagine a Pierce Brosnan having Pan Masala. So when you created that, were you ready for the kind of merciless trolling that was supposed to follow? Everywhere you saw, you had people slamming the ad. So was that kind of okay with the brand when it actually happened?
I think there is so much that was, I would say, a move which was thought out, that, you know, I know that there was some negative publicity, and I think people who consume Pan Masala comprise a very small percentage of social media. So that really didn't affect us, because we are in a world where there's too much competition for attention today, right? I mean, that's why I think controversial ads are becoming more and more commonplace, because there's an attention deficit, and we are in a world today where any publicity is good publicity. So that's the way we looked at it. And I think the sales also spoke for itself. So it really took. So for us, we are not worried about what the P&Gs and the Unilevers of the world are going to do, because the competition for Pan Bahar was Rajnigandha, it was Pan Parag, it was the Vimals of the world. And in that particular category, it worked like gangbusters. I know for a fact that it had other Pan Masala manufacturers re-looking at the strategy of celebrity endorsement after we took on Pierce Brosnan. So I would say it did what it was supposed to do.
I think you'll also find support in Mr. Bhatt, you know, who's himself made a wide range of controversial ads. To name one, I remember the Sunny Leone ad with Alok Nath, the anti-smoking one. Mr. Bhatt, the one where, you know, at that time, I remember the whole Alok Nath meme, you know, Sanskari meme was doing the rounds, and then you showed him with Sunny Leone. I mean, that was supposed to be downright right, controversial. So what was going on in your head at that point?
So I think see, controversy is a one of the thing which probably touch. I mean, there are lots of things probably can connect with the consumer. I think in that case, if I can remember, it was not about create a controversy. The casting was done to create the subject, the main idea is quantifying the life which we lose with the one cigarette. We got the data saying 11 minutes, and that 11 minutes after quantifying, if we say people, you will lose 11 minutes, they're not. I mean, many brands and even government has tried to tell people that you will die and you'll die by 11 minutes. And whatever, it did not really cut ice as much probably. So we thought that if 11 minutes of your life aspiration or a desire or as an ambition, if that gets truncated because of a one cigarette, and if I create a story around that, and then we take your aspiration could be Sunny Leone, and your person who can give permission is as good as Alok Nath, who's a good actor also. Obviously, his backstory, when we use a star, you also use his, you endorsing him. So his backstory is also come to play. So it's a contrasting theory. And then you put Deepak Dobriyal, who's doing a great acting as a patient, and then his desire being completed by meeting Sunny Leone, and that gets truncated because of a cigarette. Probably, it is a correct casting rather than controversy strategy. We did not make anything do something really, really objectionable in the commercial. So it was well received. It was one of the better viral probably our industry and Scarecrow did. And I think it worked in a level where everything, there was a media shared on cinema, and in contrast, there was an entertaining ad which was coming in a different, weaving a different threads to the consumer's mind and connecting to this and become a buzz in a smoking room. I think that was the intention. It was not an intention or not a controversy strategy at all.
Okay. Makes sense. You know, I'd like to bring you in, Prahlad. They say the cleverest thing an advertiser can do is bank opposite of what everyone else is doing, even if it gets negative publicity. Do you agree?
No, not totally, but I'll tell you what it is. See, negative publicity is a very strange phenomenon today. You have what is called in our society today, fringe loonies. Now, fringe loonies, in my term, is ultra-right, ultra-left-wing, or ultra-communal.
Okay.
Okay. They form 5 to 10% of your population mix. But they actually, share of mind and share of voice is almost 90%.
Okay.
Because they're the noisiest people you can ever imagine on earth. Because they're trolling, they're doing this, they're doing that. They're like, and nobody particularly likes what they're saying. So the easiest way to chedo a controversy, if you want one, without putting everybody off because of the controversy and still have your brand doing well, is to chedo the fringe loonies. So when you chedo the fringe loonies with something rational, but which what they don't believe in or what they've made a statement about, then come out in force. And they'll come after your product or your advertising or whatever else it is and try and get it banned depending on who the power in the center is. So don't turn around and chedo the right thing right now because you'll get banned. Instinct. But if you chedo the communal loonies or the left-wing loonies or whoever the loonies are who are slightly fanatical and about 3 to 5% of the population, they make so much noise about it that even if you've not seen the ad, you'll want to see the ad and say, kya shor macha rahe hai, itna sara? What is so desperate about it? Now the point is, 95% of the population, when they see the ad and they see who the butt end of it is, agree with you. And the 5% of the loonies are screaming their heads off and taking about, you know, a share of voice in 95%. Whereas the guys actually approve it or are sitting on the fence or don't have an opinion or whatever else it is, are not saying a word.
Right.
At the most, they'll say, like.
There's
one little thing, like. And fringe loonies will say, we don't like, vote, I don't. And they'll get we don't like. But you must understand that the fringe loonies are only 3% of your population.
Correct.
And that so much noise that it's a really interesting game to cheer them. You know, provoke the little shits so that they make the noise for you. And then if they make the noise for you, the media picks it up and everything, it becomes a multiplier. Now you take Tough Shoes. Okay, there was an ad made for Tough Shoes.
The Milind Soman ad, right.
Milind Soman and if you look at the ad, it was really aesthetically beautiful. There is nothing that you could see in it that was acceptable, except the fact that it was actually suggesting nudity. Okay, so everybody came out, you know, all the right wing, all the Shiv Sena types came out, all the right wing conservatives came out, all screamed and shouted. We were on a debate on television. And, you know, at the end of the day, what happened was that there was this lady who was the head of the Mahila Mandal who said that ye bakwas hai, basically kuch bhi kar rahe hain, gandhi cheez hai, vagaira, vagaira, all that, they're corrupting our youth. So I don't know, I told them, dekhiye, madam, jo Milind Soman aur Madhu saab pe jo hai na, Bhagwan ne bahut fursat se banaya unko. To wo kuch bhi karein aur kuch dikhaye nahi, to wo aap aur main usi pose mein khade ho jaye to we are vulgar. Because we are ugly. She was so offended. You have no idea that she didn't want to end the debate. She said, you meet me outside. I'll show you. You know, she was so offended that I called her ugly. I said, no, but I'm also ugly, na?
You were lucky you didn't get a case on you.
That was earlier. That was very, very early. So, you know, I mean, then there was that coffee ad, you know, which there's Malaika.
Malaika.
So it became extremely controversial. But at the
end of it, those products ended up getting banned for these ads, right? I think.
I don't think the coffee worked very well because they took off, actually.
Yeah.
The sales went up by about 200%. But the good thing that came out of it is the two models who didn't know each other before the ad got married.
Interesting. You know, so the way I see it is, there's this first kind of ad where the agenda is to create an uproar or controversy. And the second, perhaps, is like maybe the Surf Excel ad, Rang Laaye Sang ad, which was meant to promote communal harmony. But as soon as I think it was out, the right wing, the Hindu nationalists were up in arms against it for weeks. Now, which party would you say has more chances of succeeding? I mean, I think something similar happened with your Airtel ad, right? You didn't make it with the intention, the boss ad, the female boss ad. Yeah.
You know, that ad actually succeeded because 95% of the population said it's a great ad. And 5% of the fringe loonies said it's a horrible ad. Take it off. What do you mean? Ye vote hai tu. You know? So they all said, you're pagal ho gaya. Kya keh kya raha ho aap? So they expose themselves and their feeble-mindedness and their small thinking. The majority of this country, if you took a dipstick at that time, actually loved the ad.
Okay.
Correct.
Right. Papari, do you agree?
I completely agree, Nita. See, no clients ever comes to you and say, the brief never says, mujhe controversial ad chahiye. Okay. So there is a particular brief and you're trying to solve a problem. And while solving a problem, you may or may not create something that may create ruffle in the society. There is always a need that we don't need a TVC these days. We need a viral. We need something that will go, spread like a wildfire. So this is what the need of every client is today. And if you look at history, no single brand is built on controversy. I think you get an opportunity to do something that is topical and relevant, like what Manish and guys did with Aloknath or many other things that we keep on doing. So I'll give example of a runner. Like a runner need protein, carbs, vitamins, carbohydrate and fiber, everything. Similarly, a brand needs, I think, a variety of things. And I think conversation, I wouldn't call as controversy. I would call it much lighter and say conversation. We need conversation around every work that we create, because mm-hmm. there is a need from every brand to create something really, really moving, which again, I'm putting a word to it, which is like a viral. Hence, it has to start a conversation. The more you start, people start talking about, because today, I think most majority of our society love talking, love giving opinion. And the more you open it, the more it gets resolved. And that's exactly what happened in case of Airtel. We have never designed. In fact, we have given her as a stature of a boss. She was the head of the office. But some idiot from somewhere said, why are you making her go home and cook? No, she is doing by choice. She's not been forced by husband to go home and cook for him. So why are you not seeing the positive side? The positive side is she is the boss. So we are celebrating her. We are celebrating the community. So that is a positive thing for you guys to think about. So again, I'll try to make one point. If you're standing for something, if you want to really do a social, I think a lot of the social ads, I think Pepsi globally did the Kendall Jenner one, where they have to pull out in flat 2 days time. So are you relevant in that category? A Pepsi standing for something like that? I don't think it's right. Or the tonality wasn't right. So you have to choose what are you relevant. Are you relevant for whichever category you are standing for? Even if you are doing a social work, I always feel it should be relevant to your category. If you are doing something in the area of food and beverages, please stand for hunger in the world. Please stand for something that is relevant rather than standing for something that is absolutely no relevance. Because there are many brands in the world that will be relevant to some issues, and hence appropriate. Like I'll give example of steelfree.com, which was done, I think, 20 years back. Drogafy is one of the first celebrated work where they actually took a plane that looked like Air Force One and painted steelfree.com. And that really went viral. And as soon as the youth who went on the website, they saw that it's a fashion website where the owner was standing for anti-graffiti law, which the president has imposed. I thought that was absolutely relevant. It was the most controversial ad. Many people saw it. What the hell is this? Have the president's plane been hijacked? Are we secured? Blah, 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 blah. Many things happened. But I think the stance, the message that the brand gave there was absolutely relevant. Hence, whatever we do, whether a demo of the product or something standing for the social or doing a controversial conversation ad, you have to be relevant. Once you are relevant, right, I think you will win the race.
You know, you spoke about something interesting. You said no client will ever come to an agency asking you to make a controversial ad. Does that really happen? Shambhit, Manish, you made these ads, I think, a couple of times, and have agencies been asked to make viral controversial ads? There's a thin line between the two, honestly.
Yes, yes.
So,
you want to?
I think there's a, I would say the difference is between the word viral and controversial, right? What is viral may not be controversial, but what is controversial will probably be viral, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think any client ever say that, hey, give me a controversial ad. People obviously want to steer away from controversy. Nobody wants to be a controversy's child, so to say, or their brand to be associated with it. I think brands become, or communication becomes controversial, not because they set out to be controversial, but because something about it has been picked up by someone who has found something offensive about it, or something to ridicule about it, and it just... It just grows from there like a.
You'll always find some fringe lunatic who has his own idea of right and wrong, who stands on a pulpit and screams his head off, and media helps him. Media is the biggest culprit of them all, because they actually love controversy, and they will barkaw it and they'll flame it and they'll keep it alive long after everything else is gone because of TRPs.
Yeah. And I think for example, what Paddy gave an example of the Kendall Jenner in the Pepsi ad, I don't think they ever intended it to be controversial. Of course, it became controversial and it ended up creating a huge backlash because it was so insensitive, right? And ultimately, Pepsi retracted it. So, of course, in the heart of hearts, every client wants that the ad should go viral, but for the right reasons and not for the wrong reasons. But the thing is, that is not really in anyone's hands. You never know which way the cookie was going to crumble, right?
You know, that reminds me, I think there was this one interesting ad you made, Mr. Bhatt, the one on Yellow Pages, where there was this child, I mean, there's this husband who's looking for a divorce lawyer in the Yellow Pages as soon as he sees his son, who's very dark, and he and his wife are like relatively fair. So, you know, who would in their right mind think that the Tata would buy an idea like this? So tell me, you know, even if brands are big enough, you know, established ones, are they also keen on, you know, capturing viewers' attention with ads like these?
So we did this ad in 2001 or 2. We also got Duryodhan Award apart from Abby's and other awards. some society. And I'm
that is for gender insensitivity, right? The Duryodhan.
It's a very simple joke, and I don't think that was anything to do with the races or anything. It's just that it happens to be a dark child. I mean, obviously, it was not intended to attack at the race. See, I think we come to the first question that does the client tell you to do to make it viral? Yes, mm-hmm. they do say, but commonality between controversy and viral and love. हो जाता है कभी मतलब किया नहीं जाता है वायरल भी हो जाता है कंट्रोवर्सी भी हो जाती है प्यार भी हो जाता है सो इट हैपेंस बेसिकली नोबडी इंटेंड्स टू सी आई थिंक इफ यू जस्ट फंडामेंटली सी एडवर्टाइजिंग इज ऑल अबाउट एनहांसिंग द प्रोडक्ट स्टोरीज नाउ इफ समटाइम्स प्रोडक्ट हैज अ ग्रेट स्टोरी वी विल एनहांस दैट बट समटाइम्स प्रोडक्ट डज नॉट हैव ग्रेट स्टोरी वी स्टिल हैव टू मेक बैड प्रोडक्ट लुक गुड इन द पब्लिक परसेप्शन एंड फॉर विच We need to make our communication should evoke 9 out of 9 rasas, right? Usme log hasya ras ya karun ras ya raudra ras ya shant ras, ye sab ya adbhut ras ke liye to kuch bolta nahi. But there's one controversial ras there, which has been utilized very rarely in literature also, which is bibhats ras, which is discussed. Which actually very rarely used. Even Ramcharitmanas mein Tulsidas ne ek doha maine nikal ke rakha tha ki usme wo likha hai ki vishta pui rudhir kachhada bardhai kabhu upal bahu chhada kabhi vishta kabhi khun kabhi bal haddiya barsata tha meghnad uske usme aise sab varnan hai manto ki likhai dekhiye Khushwant Singh Bhishma Sahani and lot of writers have written in literature In this disgust or a bibhats ras, the partition time ke kafi sare stories has been written like that. But it has been less used. Advertising also sometimes use this out of 9 rasa 1. But we actually walk near the thin line. Ba ek taraf hum log client aur world bolta hai push the boundary. Jab hum boundary ke us paar chale jaate hai, to people come
and say. So you know, in that case. Tell me, you know, in many cases, you managed to shock the consumer, yes. But is that the same as convincing a consumer to buy your product? You know, otherwise, it just becomes a case of, you know, you provided some entertainment for your audience and their brand got its 10 minutes in the spotlight and then you probably won an award. And then that's it. Who cares about long-term brand building? Does that happen?
This stunt won't lead to brand building at all. It's a one-off. It just covers the awareness part of it. The affinity with the brand cannot be like you can't have a continued stunts only. I think Prahlad and Paddy and all also should answer this part.
No, when you want awareness, like for instance, Yellow Pages. Was a very low interest area for most people. So it wasn't that you're trying to sell the Yellow Pages, you're trying to sell the fact that it's convenient, you can find anything in it. And that awareness was very necessary, and they're not going to run campaigns for the rest of their lives trying to build the brand and the value of the brand. What is it? It's a very, very quick reference, what you call Yellow Pages, where you can find anything in it. So if you have one really viral or slightly controversial ad, They've solved the problem because then everybody is talking about that particular thing and you're talking about Yellow Pages. So when you turn up, okay, if Yellow Pages is involved in a controversy, that who is Yellow Pages? What is Yellow Pages? Yellow Pages is a glossary of people or professionals who you can find in Yellow Pages. Enough. It's done its job.
Right.
Yeah, and I'll just add a bit, Neeta. I think things were very different 15, 20 years back. The times have become very sensitive. As I said, because of digital medium, because of internet, because of social media, people are just waiting to create issue out of nothing. There are millions of people who are just sitting there, as Prahlad kept on saying, just to make issue out of nothing. And if today Manish was given that same brief, I think they will think twice before doing that ad. Hence, I think those were a time where many things were allowed, and hence we did many things that was beyond our imagination. And thanks to many times we have got away with it. If we could do those things, I think we'll be killed today. I mean, we'll be killed literally. I think there is a big religious body, and I've gone through many. I'll just give one example. We have gone through many, especially I have gone through many. I think it was second year of my advertising career. I was in Mudra, and my school friend was a DTDC courier franchisee. So he said, "Arey, chota sa black and white ad dena hai publication mein, sir, just do one typo thing and give." I said, "Arey, there is an opportunity, because being a kid, when you're junior, everything is an opportunity for you." I said, "Nahi yaar, isko kuch acha karte." So I convinced him to do an ad where Hanuman is carrying the Sanjeevani Mountain. And we said, delivery ke liye courier boys chahiye. It got released in midday. It got released in some Navakal. And in the evening, he get a call from two goons saying, how the hell can you do this? So they landed at his house. We used to stay in a chawl. Okay, it's a 1+1 chawl. So then he called me on my landline in Mudra. I came at 7:30. When these idiots saw with orange tikka and all, saying ki dono to yaar lango chaddi mein hai, ye log kya paisa denge, ye log kya karenge, in flat 20 minutes they said, "Sorry, bolo, ek letter likho aur bhago yahan se." Now, if there was a big brand, they would have milked it. And believe me, I have gone through many such incidents where these guys, if there is a brand, they will expect a big chunk of money from you. And if you're doing a social thing, then they will say, do a lot of tandav, and they will take a sorry note from you, just to keep it in their file. I think this has been practicing, because there are many religious body who survive only on this, who survive only looking at finding things jahan pe loophole hai, kuch baja sakte hai kya inki. I think there are many religious party from either side, from all the sides, which I think because we industry body is little weak, hence we have been attacked. We don't have many guardrails. We are not united. ASCII has taken some strong stance on many things, but still we are not united. The fact is the kind of liberty that Bollywood gets. We don't even get 10%. Though ek ad ke beech mein 20 second ka condom ka ad aayega, to we get budge out. Whereas a condom ke ad ke baad mein rip scene hai wo film mein. But they are given that liberty. It's the same child, it's the same father, it's the same family who is watching that as well. So why the hell we have been penalized for years? And I think it's a sensitive issue where we have to come together. Somebody has spotted saying, "Inme to unity nahi hai. Todo, fodo, jinko jo chahiye." Why? We are a 70,000 crore industry. Why can't we come together? Why can't we put some freedom? Because we are in the field of creativity, and every creative field needs certain freedom, needs some expression. And there are brand guys who are very sensitive about what we do. They put a lot of filters. ये होने के बावजूद some idiots come and saying कि this is not right, this is wrong, this has to be done in a particular way. Sorry, we understand, we are matured enough in our society as citizens. We understand our consumers. So why are you so sensitive about many things that you are not sensitive about Bollywood? So as I said, this is because we are not united. We are not united. I mean, look at Ashok Pandit. He stands for everything in Bollywood. He's a president of Bollywood body. And whatever issue, he just goes head on. I wish we can hire him to our industry.
And Bipin Pandit to do that.
No, that's an important point. That's food for thought, I think, there. And I think Shombit wanted to leave the discussion. He had told me he wants to. Do you want to still?
Oh, I've got 5 minutes, so...
Okay. So there's this one last question I want to ask you. Taking out from what Paddy has said, there is a section of population out there who's trying to create ruckus, and then there is a genuine section out there who just takes offense. You know, conservative lot. Any ad technically which is made a little ahead of its time becomes controversial. I think long back, there was this Manisha Lamba ad for Femina, which was speaking about widow remarriages. It didn't really go down well with the audiences. And there are like a couple of other examples also like that. So what happens to the brand now? Does it have to worry about, you know, antagonizing the loyal but conservative set, or does it, look forward to getting more people on board, you know, as consumers? Prahlad, do you want to take that?
See, the point is that, as I said, you have your fringe loonies and some of them are extortionists. Now, you have organization in Bangalore called Ram Sene. You remember them?
They right. The Valentine's Day ruckus creators, right?
They did a ruckus. They blackened some guy's face because he was dating a girl. What is he expected to do? Date a boy? And then they went into oblivion because everybody came out and started sending them pink chaddis or some shit like that. You know, there was a huge women's movement where they were posting them pink chaddis, you know, from all over the country. So they went slightly underground. But do you know that India Today did a expose on them where they had become just a lumpen body, and they said, koi tod fod karna hai, you can hire us. For so much money, we will do this. For so much money, we will do that. For so much money, we'll create a controversy for you. Now, you know, I mean, if you have bodies like this, which affiliate themselves with right wing, left wing, top wing, bottom wing, and they have godfathers to protect them, they can sell their services for anything because the media picks it up. Now, I've always been telling media this, that when you think somebody has got an angle into it and they're not doing it out of genuine concern for the large mass of people who actually enjoy what you're doing, then mm-hmm. you might actually blacklist them, in the sense, black them out. Don't give them free publicity. Because the moment mm-hmm. anybody who wants free publicity gets up and starts tod-foding or something. Now, you know, if you look at our politics, if you don't break something, if you don't put a bund, if you don't destroy, if you don't cause lots of damage, you don't get carried. So why is it that people who are destructive and who are, you know, out and out gundas, they get the media coverage? The good guys never get the media coverage.
Right, right. No, and before I end this discussion, I just like to close with one. I'd like to ask each of you one favorite controversial ad, which according to you has really worked. I'll start with you, Shambhit, because you have to leave. Which is your favorite controversial ad so far, apart from the one you made?
Something very recent. I think sometimes controversy also stems from the brand taking a stand. And I think that Colin Kaepernick ad for Nike, it's one of my favorites. Believe in something, even if it means sacrificing everything. The basketball player, Colin Kaepernick. So, and it led to a lot of social media outrage, people destroying Nike apparel, shoes, socks. There's a burn your Nike's hashtag. But I think it benefited the brand immensely because the brand was brave enough to take a stance by getting Colin Kaepernick on board. So that would definitely have to be up there for me.
Okay. Manish, your turn.
So I think I have one hours and one word, whatever. One is the Benetton Unhit. I think that did its job in a simplest manner. And one, I think Prahlad was a consultant to that brand, and we used to handle Rupa. So we had an aspiration that koi kuch aisa ad banaye jispe shobhade jaise log uske bare mein likhe. I mean, one should write like that. So we our aspiration got fulfilled by that ad. We shot in Prague. There were tubs, like Milind Soman kind of guy, obviously wearing a skin colored thing, but obviously not nude, but pretended to be nude. And he was holding roosters at his crotch and saying, what's your size? And it did its job. A lot of people wrote about it, against it, including Shobhade. So my wish got fulfilled. It was a full page.
I hope she's watching.
And did not stop running that ad ever. DNA and wherever possible. It's a theater of mind which we're playing. We never said what we're supposed to say. Like, we show a husband cutting, a groom cutting tag, and the bride thinks it's genital, but he's cutting his tag in his bride's chamber for his undergarment, It's a theater of mind which we're working on. We are not saying anything.
That's what
advertising and creativity is all about. We are not saying anything.
You're just playing with your mind. Right, right. Paddy, your turn.
The people who think.
I think
put everything in, you know.
Unke dimag gande hai, agar gande hai to.
Yeah, I think I really adore the Nike as a brand who has been standing for edgy work, edgy that becomes controversial. Be it, I think, Lance Armstrong's or Tiger Woods, I think, during his controversy. Nike always did or promoted these characters who were on a negative split. I think apart from this Colin Kaepernick, I love one more which wasn't globally reached every corner the way it happened with Colin's ad. It was I think somewhere in US, one part where a lot of youngsters were victim of drugs. So what the local mayor did, he took a church that wasn't used, old big church that wasn't used by the locals, because there were many new churches that have come up. So the brand decided to convert that church into a basketball court, by which all the druggies, youngsters who were around that church, they got an opportunity to come together and sports became the reason for them to get rid of drugs. I thought this was a very, very brave, courageous thing. It won at many places, including a design Grand Prix at Cannes as well, which is Space Design. I thought the brand really stands or touch upon the, again, I think this was very, very relevant. How can you make sports, which is your core, how can you make that as a basic facility to the youth? Hence, I feel the relevance part is quite strong here. You are not selling a product or a set of product, but you're standing for a cause, and that's for the welfare of the society. And I think I wish I could have done this. So this just moves me.
Absolutely. And Prahlad, your turn.
Well, you know, I'm the child of controversy. From day one, I've had more ads banned by censors than any single person in this country. But I didn't find anything wrong with it. I actually challenged them to a certain extent and said, why do you want to ban this? I mean, what is the rationale? And they said, no, we are the censor board or we are the censor body, and we've decided that you cannot do this in ads. So I said, who the hell are you? You know, I mean, we've got ASCII, we've got all these people who actually allowed this ad to go on, and you arbit some little government clerk who decides that, you know, stretcher bearers carrying a patient on a stretcher can't drop this patient in the middle of the road because they see a runaway suitcase come hurtling at them, you know. But even the stretcher bearer got up, the stretcher chap got up and ran off. They actually banned it. And they said, no, the organization of stretcher bearers will complain to us that they are not allowed to drop patients so carelessly on the ground.
Okay.
You go to any government hospital and see what they're doing there in the corridors. I mean, what are you talking about? But the point is that, you know, there's no specific ad that I can say was either my favorite controversy or non-favorite controversy. But the fact is that Nike stands out actually for a lot of controversy because they actually turn on and have an attitude. And what Nike is selling is not shoes. They're selling it. That comma of theirs is they just do it. It doesn't matter what you're doing. So right. I remember Wimbledon ad, which came out just before Wimbledon. Everybody is desperately laying lines. They're building the net. People are running around desperately trying to get the court in order. And this dog comes across, sniffs at that post of where the net is being hanged, raises his hind leg and pees on it and goes off. And it says, Nike, just do it.
Wow.
So, I mean, it was so completely out of the box. It was completely unexpected. I looked at it and I almost fell down laughing. But somebody has to turn on and find objection in it. And we have so many people in social media today who are empowered to turn and give an opinion because they have the place in the sun. So the point is, in a way, social media is good because it actually gives people the power to have an opinion and you can engage with them if you choose to. But it also gives a whole lot of absolute yahoos the power to want to be known because they want to criticize somebody. And out of complete negativity and pure blood negativity, nothing else. There's nothing positive about it at all.
Right. And that's actually reminds me to take a question which is on similar lines. An anonymous attendee says there's a large chunk of population who love little dark humor, little controversy and little edgy stories, even in the form of ads. But because of a small chunk of, armchair activists on social media who oppose everything under the sun, the audience doesn't really get to see those kind of ads. So do brands today need to be more courageous? What do you think?
Nita, sorry, I'll butt in here. I'll need to take your leave. It was really lovely chatting with all of you. But Pralhad, please continue. Sorry to...
No.
Yep.
Sure.
Thank you.
Nita. Thank you so much for joining, Shambhit. We're just closing it anyway.
Bye.
I hope you're a tough client and I hope you're not going to ask them for the money that they owe you. Because they're going to say, we're not going to pay you because of COVID.
Yeah.
Okay. But he's absolutely right what he said. Because I've always maintained that 5% of your people who like to make controversies out of nothing do it to get attention for themselves. They're all attention seekers. They've done nothing in their lives which will actually give them some sunlight. But they will ride on somebody else's talent. They'll ride on somebody else's creativity and turn around and criticize it so that the media picks it up and says, this guy, he's head of this little group of people who are right-wing, left-wing, top, down, bottom, underwear activists who turn around and say that this is wrong. And therefore, they start a dialogue with them. And for that 1 or 2 days when that controversy rages, these people get their moment in the sun for doing nothing except being negative. So, at some stage, we're going to get, as a population, we're going to get fed up and turn around and tell them to shut up, even in social media. And I'm waiting for that day because it's very close. So we turn around and say, mind your own business, just do your own thing and don't get involved in something that doesn't concern you or doesn't matter. We like it and that's it.
Right. Thank you so much. Paddy wants to add something. Yeah.
Good. Some time back, we were thinking on this. Because of social media or because of the behavior in the social media or the attack via social media on brands or creative work has actually made a lot of clients very sensitive. Even if there are 2 to 3 comments which are negative compared to 50,000 comments which are positive, brands seems to becoming very sensitive and hence the edginess, the weapons that we used to use earlier have been taken away from us. We are a lot more less creative compared to what we were 10 years back. Will we able to do a Tough Shoes ad today? I don't think so. We'll have courage to do that kind of thing. But that's again one of my favorite ads because if you run that ad, it's ageless. It will run today. It's such a beautiful ad. We always say minimize everything when you want to sell a product. I'm just taking literally, they have minimized everything and just put the shoes in front of you. So what else do you see? Obviously, I think somewhere the industry people or consumers need to be a little more sensitive. They should, it's like if you give a toy to a youngster, to a bachu, he will play with it for a while. And that's the exact same sentiment mindset which is happening with our consumer. Digital has opened up, internet has opened up. Hence, they are like going whole hog without thinking anything. Be it advertising, be it on issues, be it on COVID. I think people are not at all sensitive about what they are saying. Mujhe mila hai platform, mujhe type karne aata hai, toh let me just rant. I think it impacts many, 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 many things. But I think we will grow up with maturity. 5, 7, 10 years down the line, I think our approach towards social media will be far different. But if we don't keep on sensitizing people, I think we'll keep on suffering more.
Super. Manish, any closing thoughts?
I think people originally started, there used to be a very सिंपल सतयुग में सिर्फ गुड एंड इविल होता था, सच झूठ होता है. स्लोली स्लोली वी गॉट इवॉल्व्ड एंड देन नाउ वी हैव ग्रे शेड्स, सो मेनी ग्रे शेड्स. सो द मीडिया रिफ्लेक्टेड, द क्रिएटर्स रिफ्लेक्टेड, द एडवर्टाइजर रिफ्लेक्टेड टू यूज ऑल दिस ग्रे शेड्स. नाउ ऑब्वियसली देयर इज अ वेरी थिन लाइन बिटवीन देम, इट क्रॉसेस, बट वी शुड हैव टू टेक इट, वी एज अ सोसाइटी हैव टू टेक इट एज अ पिंच ऑफ सॉल्ट दैट ओके इट हैपेंस. But now making a big gaga over these kind of things, like MTV and advertising actually taught work to Indian society and everything. 10 years back, 12 years back, 15 years back, it was such a beautiful world. We all joined advertising because of that, communication because of that. If we lose that edge, why we used to enter advertising, MTV and MTV generation we used to call, and advertising, because none of the other medium, literature, anything, were not allowing to express quirkiness. And that itself has been getting killed day by day and making us very, very logical. Sheer reason why we came into, because we used to express those edginess. And that is it. That itself is under threat and under the curb. I think that is where the, like, you know, we used to know people like Prahlad in this industry. We used to know that that Cyrus is in my MTV doing this, where we see this ad is very, you know, edgy and all. That's the reason we came. Now, what is it?
Super, super. So if I may sum up, I'd like to say, you know, to everyone, every ad maker out there contemplating on creating the next bold shocker of an ad, if you're creating a controversial ad for the right reasons, do it with conviction, because I think nothing can propel a brand faster than, you know, a controversial ad, which is, like I mentioned, for the right reasons. So in three words, I think make it large. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining me on this wonderful discussion. I think this was one of the best we've had in the recent history. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks,
Sita. Bye, guys. Bye, Pranav. Bye, Manish.
Bye, guys. Here's more bye, power. Nita. Now, remember, the next platform is OTT. You can say what you want and get away with it.
Surely. Thank you, Prahlad. Thank you, Manish. Thank you, Paddy.